I'm good. How are you?
Good. Thanks for doing this.
Yeah, you're welcome. Good. Do you know how many people are anticipated on coming?
I don't. Our level of Zoom membership doesn't allow pre-registration. That costs quite a bit more money, so we'll see. We tried to spread the word as best we could, so.
Oh, cool.
hopefully we'll get a good turnout.
Yeah, I told my friends at school, we have a bird club, but I don't know if anyone will remember. This is just fine.
So let's see. I want to make sure I can give you the right to share your screen. Okay, advanced sharing options. So yeah, I think the best way to do it is going to be to make you the host.
Okay.
And then I might have you, I don't know if there, so we usually do like our, this is the first time we've done one of these online. So we usually do like bird gossip about what birds people are seeing, and our president, whoever, we don't have job titles, but the person who's in charge usually talks a little bit. I might try to do that at the end, just to kind of like let you go right away once we have everybody in the room. So, but then I might ask you to make me the host again when you're done.
Okay.
So are you, you have Zoom experience?
Yeah. I mean, I'm definitely not an expert, but I am like very comfortable in it.
Okay. So you know how to make me the host once you're done.
Yeah. Is it on the, I know we can try it now.
Okay. So here, I'm making you the host.
And you're, Linda wants to come in.
Yeah. I was going to wait a little bit. Just.
Yeah, that's fine. So I am the host. So then.
If you click on participants next to my name where it says more, there should be an option to make host.
Oh, okay, there we go. Okay, that's right. Okay.
Cool.
That will work. So should I try sharing my screen now and just run through everything and make sure it works?
Sure.
So that's just my PowerPoint, right?
Yep. Yeah, that's all I see.
Cool.
Awesome. That'll work great.
Okay. Yeah, I had a presentation already made, but it was not my own. And so I wanted to change a bunch of things, and yeah, I got carried away with some things.
That's good. Got some great pictures.
I didn't take like any of them, but most of them have photo credits. Yeah, like this is
that's amazing.
a really good one. And he, Bobby, has a lot of other cool photos online. I think he actually has like a Flickr or something, which like, okay, you know, people use, but not as much. He worked for the Nature Conservancy down there at the site where we got some of our birds. Yeah.
That's cool.
And then the guy who was in the tree is another one who has really good photos, and I'll talk about them, that organization. Okay, that works. And then I had a bunch of extra ones that were just there in case people might have had questions about other things.
Okay.
So, yeah, if they had questions and needed a visual. So, okay, that's cool. That all works. And you can hear me fine?
Yeah, you sound great.
Okay, good. Yeah, nobody's here, so it's just me using the Wi-Fi. So that should be good. So do you want to be the host again now?
Sure. Then I can introduce you and start letting people in the room in a minute here.
Yeah. There we go.
Cool. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I know. So I'm trying to, this is the Conservation District Zoom account. We're looking into maybe buying the webinar level, and it's super expensive.
How much is it?
It was going to be like a couple $100 a month.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's not, I don't think that's what, is there not like another thing that's free? Like what about Google or Microsoft or?
We haven't tried, so I have a lot of Teams meetings, Microsoft for work, that other people host, mm-hmm. and I've not been very impressed with it so far, but
mm-hmm.
I was in a webinar on Zoom where somebody else had a webinar, and it was like, this is actually really good, like, you have all kinds of capabilities that I don't have,
mm-hmm.
but that is a lot of money, and it's just, it's so open-ended, no one knows when this is going to be over.
Right, yeah. Yeah, they gave us all like premium accounts for school, which is really nice.
That's awesome.
So that's helpful, but I'm only supposed to really use it for school technically. And then where I'm like an AmeriCorps member right now at a land trust, and where we're at, we have one Zoom account that's like premium.
Okay.
That we can share, and then the rest is Microsoft. Which, yeah, it doesn't have a lot of the stuff. And Zoom's been around a little longer for, like, conference call purposes. So I think it's just more, like, established.
Yeah. Yep. See any good birds lately?
No. I really haven't gone out that much. We did our Monadnock Region Birding Cup on Saturday. And I went out with two people from my school, and then someone else from the community came with us. So we were in Hinsdale at the rail trail there.
Yeah.
The old, and I went out like midday because I was busy in the morning doing other things. But they were out for like 12 hours. And I mean, we saw a northern Parula and American Red Star, which was exciting for that time of day. Oh. Let me just take this phone call.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry.
Good evening.
Good evening.
This is going to be fun.
I hope so. This is our first time doing this, so.
Wonderful. We're happy you're doing it.
Good. I'm glad.
How did your canoe trip go last week, or your kayak?
Actually, I was the only person who showed up. So I had a lovely solo kayak paddle, but there was not much out that night. It was really quiet. And there weren't any Nighthawks on the move, which surprised me because, it's been a big August for them. There were tons for several days. It's hard to know when they're going to move.
It is. It's tricky. There's another voice.
So I thought that might have been my boyfriend calling from Keene because he's going to grad school at Keene State. Okay. But it was just someone trying to get me to vote for people. I was like, oh my gosh, did he lose his cell phone and he had to call from the school? Like, why would Keene be calling me? No. he just wanted me to vote for someone. And I was like, oh, I don't live in Keene anymore. Sorry.
Well, we had thought we might go on the paddle, but, you know, it's starting to get dark so early and it was a warm night. And I thought, I guess I'm not too excited about it tonight.
But it ended up being kind of a cool night out on the water.
Yeah, another time, maybe a little earlier in the year, a couple of weeks earlier might
be. Yeah, it's such a tough needle to thread. We tried it last year or the year before. I think it was 2 years ago. And we did it a little bit earlier and the weather was nice, but there were no birds. We were hoping there'd be shorebirds on the move and you just never quite know when that's going to happen.
Yeah, that's true. They don't come on schedule.
No, they really don't.
Have you been up to any of the hawk watch spots yet this year?
I haven't. I know Putney's asking visitors not to come.
Right.
They
do list them in their reports.
Yep. they've had some good stuff so far, some goshawks, which is nice.
I kind of watch Putney and Pac-Monadnock.
I've never been over there. I want to go sometime.
Oh, you'd enjoy it. It's a fun place to go. We've only been once, but we enjoyed it.
Okay. They had a Swanson's hawk maybe 3 or 4 years ago.
Oh.
It's a pretty good bird out here.
Yeah.
Good evening, Corey.
Good evening. How are you?
I'm relaxing.
That's good. Anything good out on your farm? No, I've been pretty quiet.
I wouldn't say it's quiet. We got a lot going on right now.
I believe that.
As far as birds, there's nothing other than sparrows I haven't used too many starlings lately.
Well, there have been some young witch hawks here that make a lot of noise.
Okay.
We did have a downy woodpecker outside of our kitchen window tonight.
Okay.
It's a hummingbird last night. It was up in Brattleboro, actually.
Okay.
In the afternoon. Yeah.
But nothing really strange here at the farm as far as birds go.
Okay. Did you ever figure out if that bluebird earlier in the summer, if that was a western or a mountain bluebird?
I went back down and I never saw it again, but I assumed it was nesting there. But
well, we decided it was just a strange color.
Yeah.
We saw it a couple of different times, not real well, but I think it was just a lighter color than normal.
Okay.
Yeah,
it looked like a male bluebird with a white chest.
Yeah, it was an interesting picture. I stared at it for a while. There was a mountain bluebird down in, I think it was Turner's Falls Airport a couple of years, 3 years ago.
Really?
Yeah. So it's not unprecedented.
Huh. What has Susan been seeing?
I've been seeing relatives lately.
Right. The birds.
Yeah. But we don't, it's been pretty quiet at Arbor Hill. We got the woods right behind us and there are usually a lot of birds, but what I'm hearing now are birds that are permanent residents. I haven't really Hi, Sally. I haven't really seen much, but we had a strange thing last night about 11 o'clock. There was something, some animal behind the condos, meaning on the west side in the woods, and it was making a huge racket, and of course we couldn't see it. I have no idea what it was. It was persistent, like it was calling for another animal, on and on and on, and then it stopped, but I don't know what it was.
Interesting.
So, be nice to see it. Be nice to have a little spotlight I could put out there sometimes.
Sure. I've always thought it'd be fun to have a trail cam.
Yes.
My nephew in Michigan.
That'd be a good place cam. Because the birds are coming down through the woods, way up Orchard Street, going up towards Marlboro and Dummerston eventually. It's pretty continuous woods. So it'd be kind of nice to have a trail cam there. But then they end up in Western Avenue. So they get down here and they have to turn around and go back.
Yeah.
Anybody been up to Hogback for the banding yet?
No. Okay. I was going to go, but then we had a COVID scare in the neighborhood and all of us had to get tested, so I couldn't go anywhere until I knew we were all nine of us were negative.
Wow. Well, that's good news. We're just going to stall for a couple minutes longer. Hopefully we get some more people in here. So I think, Audrey, once I make you the host, you might have to manage if anybody like wants to join. It should pop up. It should pop up on your screen and say someone's trying to join. So you don't have to like sit and stare at the entry list. That's one of the reasons I wish we had the webinar level, because then I could manage that while you presented.
Mm-hmm.
Sally and Peter, it's nice to see you. How's up north? Oh, she's muted. Corey, can you unmute her?
Yeah, I think so. I can ask to unmute, it says. Mm-hmm.
I'll just unmuted me, so.
She's looking for her unmute button.
So it should be located bottom left.
Got it. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, we hear you.
Hi.
Hi.
Good to see you, people.
Good to see you and hear you.
Thanks for sending the invite.
Well, we're glad that it worked.
Yeah, I didn't know if it would.
Yeah, we're just trying to start to get some of our programs on Zoom and see how it goes.
Mm-hmm. We don't know when we're going to be able to do in-person stuff yet. It could be a while.
We don't.
Yeah. So last night, Paul and I just sent notice out all the email addresses that I had.
Oh, that's a lot. So
I'm glad it reached you, Sally.
It did. It was a surprise, nice surprise.
Yeah. I think we're going to have to do a lot more of this.
Yeah.
The Vermont Center for Eco Studies is doing more Zoom stuff too, and they're feeling their way through it.
Yeah. And also we'll try to be organized more than just the night before.
I'm going to put in the chat box the website in case anybody doesn't have it. And that's a good place to keep up on, when stuff's coming up, we always try to put something on there.
say something?
No, I want to see what he's putting in the chat box.
She looks like somebody here.
Yeah, I thought she was.
Do you guys want to start, Corey?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so thank you for being here tonight. Hopefully, maybe some more people will trickle in as we start, but we'll go ahead and get started. Audrey Boraski is a graduate student at Antioch, and she is going to share her work on red-cockaded woodpeckers in the Great Dismal Swamp with us. And I'm going to go ahead and make her the host so she can share her screen.
Okay. Cool. So let me see if I did this right. Cool. So everyone can see the PowerPoint.
Yes.
Yes.
Excellent. And everyone can hear me just fine.
Yep.
Yes.
Cool. So I think our plan was to try and hold questions until the end. So maybe if you have them, either write them down on paper or if you know how to put in the chat, that would be cool. And then we can try to answer them at the end. But if you have anything burning and you just want to scream it out, that's fine too. So yeah, I think I just let someone else in. Yep, someone's coming in right now. So thanks so much for having me, and Corey for asking me, and the Southeastern Vermont Audubon Society for hosting this. My name is Audrey Boraski, and I am a master's student at Antioch University in Keene, New Hampshire, studying conservation biology. I'm also currently an AmeriCorps member at Hilltown Land Trust in Ashfield, Massachusetts, working as a land stewardship coordinator. I got my Bachelor's of Science in Biology from Keene State College in 2017, and I've completed multiple seasons as a wildlife technician or intern or volunteer at many different organizations since around 2014. So this is just my experience and story of the work that I did at the Great Dismal Swamp National Wildlife Refuge on their red-cockaded woodpecker reintroduction project. So I did not know much about birding prior to this job. I took an ornithology course and that was about it. And I was really surprised with the strong and popular community that was associated with it. And I consider myself a birder now, and it's a part of my identity and I really love it. And you might be able to see behind me, there's a poster that is the North American, the Birds of North America, the complete guide, which apparently isn't complete, but yeah, so I'm definitely into birding now and I'm really happy to be here. So let's start talking about the birds. And this is actually a photo of the swamp very early in the morning. It's very like foggy. So woodpeckers. Apparently there's around 22 woodpeckers throughout the United States. And this is a photo that I stole from the internet that is showing all of them. And according to my book here, there is 23. So this is my Peterson's guide to woodpeckers of the North America. So yep, we have our like resident downies and hairies. And I was working with the red-cockaded woodpecker. So which one is the red-cockaded woodpecker? So most of you probably know, because I'm sure you're really good birders. That and that are really good indicators of telling the difference between these two. The hairy and the downy woodpecker. The really long bill on the hairy and the shorter bill on the downy. And here's our red-cockaded woodpecker. So me, 22-year-old me who landed this job, was looking at all three of these birds like, what? So the big cheek patch is a really strong indicator of identifying the red-cockaded woodpecker, where you can see the hairy and the downy do not have those. And also they have this, the red-cockaded woodpeckers have this ladder across their back feathers here, where the downy and hairy do not. So it's completely covered. There's no big white spots. So why cockaded? Why? What does cockade mean? It just means, it's an old term for a hat decoration. So similar to the hairy and downy with the red spots on the back of the male's heads, the red cockaded has a small one that you can see when it gets excited. But other than that, the male and the female are pretty much identical. So, I don't know about any of you, but I was definitely wondering why I've never heard or seen of these birds before I got this job. And it would be because I grew up in the Northeast in Massachusetts and went to school in New Hampshire, and I never lived down in their range. So their home range is from southeastern Vermont, all the way down to Florida, and then all the way over to Texas. And it used to be even larger than that. Virginia, sorry. So now that you saw their home range, where was I working and where was I going? So I was working at the Great Dismal Swamp, and if any of you are familiar with Virginia Beach, it's close to that area. It was right bisected by the North Carolina border. So some of the swamp was actually in the border in North Carolina, while some was in Virginia. And it's really huge. So if you have a smartphone or a tablet or on your computer and you go on to Google Maps and you type in the Great Dismal Swamp, you can actually see it really, really easily. It was roughly 116,000 acres. When I was there, and then plus the state park, which took up this chunk that looks like it's missing here, so it made it even bigger. And if you can see the red on the map that's around the swamp, that is the approximate historical extent of the area where it used to go before it was all built up and logged around that area. So this is zoomed in even more to the borders of the swamp. And this is a map of the water control structures there. And also they show the coloring of the ground surface elevation. So what the water table was higher in the areas that were darker and lower in the areas that were more green. So this area over here that was more green was a lot more dry than like the areas over here. So this was the exact area of where we decided to manage the forest for the woodpeckers, because there's a lot of pine trees there and that's what they live in. And if we zoom in even more to their specific habitat, they live in an endangered habitat called a pine savanna, and it's their ideal habitat, and it consists of mature pine forests. Longleaf pine in particular is what they prefer, but they will live in loblolly pine trees. Only 1% of this threatened ecosystem remains in the country, and only 3% of the red-cockaded woodpecker population remains from pre-colonial America. The rest have just been reintroduced and translocated around the world with the standard protocol.
We went to in South Carolina.
And so for some of the reasons that this habitat has gone away is because of habitat degradation and improper logging techniques from a really long time ago, and lack of fire to these systems. They need fire to thrive. And so that was the ideal pine savanna. It was very low understory, tall grasses, and mostly just pine trees. But this is more of what the swamp actually looked like. And I don't know if you can tell from these photos, but it doesn't really look like that last picture I just showed. The understory was a lot taller, and there wasn't nearly as many pine trees. And so this is a photo of me in the top left on the ground. and my supervisor was all the way at the top of the ladder, and she took the photo, and I would hook things up to this rope and send them up to her while she was working on the cavity holes. And then this lower photo right underneath that one is just a straight out view from her being way at the top of the ladder. And then this is another similar view, the larger photo, but you can actually see the white stripes on the tree. If you can see where my mouse is, I'm not sure if you can see that, if that's showing up on Zoom. But yeah, you can see the white stripes, and that's where the nest box was put inside of the tree. And we'll talk more about that soon. Great, and so then this is a picture of their cavity zoomed in even more. So I showed you where they lived in the US, and then I showed you where they lived in southeastern Virginia, and then I showed you where they lived at the swamp, and then their ideal habitat, and now we're all the way into their cavities. So on the left is a natural, really active cavity with lots of like pine resin around it, and on the right would be, you can see it's obviously a bird, a box that's put inside of a tree. It doesn't look as natural. Okay, so why is this bird so special anyways, aside from the fact that birds are awesome and they're all special? and why are they worth all this time and effort? A lot of it has to do with their very specific life histories and their very specific habitats that they like to live in. And due to the fact that their habitat is gone is a large reason why they are gone. They're not really hunted for any reason. It's really mostly their habitat. So they are considered a keystone species of their really specific pine savanna habitat. They create habitat for many other critters, up to 27 other known birds and animals, including American kestrels, screech owls, southern flying squirrels, will all use their cavities. I read online once that it was similar to like a hotel room. Once the woodpeckers have moved out, the other animals will use it until the tree, you know, rots away and dies. Another thing that's really unique to the red-cockaded woodpeckers compared to other woodpeckers is that they roost and nest and forage in live pine trees. They prefer trees that have some heart rot to it in the center of the tree. So it's softer in the center, but the tree is still alive. So they really can't just live anywhere. They need to live in these live trees. And they also make their own cavities. They make their own homes. They don't use other ones like other birds do. And they also breed in social groups called clusters. So there's typically only one breeding pair per cluster. So they're also, you know, reaching this sexual maturity and breeding later than other birds would be doing. Their first year that they would be able to breed, the males sacrifice that, and they help out with the cluster and with the eggs that hatched and fledged. They help out with the newborn babies that year, and then the next year they'll join a new cluster and try to lay their own. So yeah, very specific compared to other birds. They also, some interesting facts about their conservation status. They're federally endangered in the US, so as we know, that's a really big deal. They're also state endangered in the state of Virginia, and they're near threatened on the IUCN red list. So the objectives for the reason that the Great Dismal Swamp National Wildlife Refuge was so interested in reintroducing them there was a lot of different reasons. It was like they were historically there, so they wanted to align the mission of the National Wildlife Refuge system with their actions that they were taking. So protecting land for wildlife, and they wanted to be, you know, actively doing that. So they decided that this would be a great project to undertake. There was also a nearby property that had really great success rates in reintroducing red-cockaded woodpeckers, so they figured it would be feasible. And also, like I said earlier, their historical range used to go a lot higher than southeastern Virginia. There have been reports that it even went as high as southern New Jersey and Pennsylvania. So to grow that population again, they were part of a group that was trying to extend that population throughout the state again, which was, the Red-cockaded Woodpecker Recovery Plan of having at least 100 potential breeding groups in the South, in the Northeast, North Carolina, Southeast Virginia, essential support population. So kind of a mouthful. Okay, so now we know what they look like and where they live and why they're so special and worth the reintroduction efforts. So how is this even possible? How does this work? How do they reintroduce this tiny little bird? Like, how do they capture it and how do they manage the forest? This is a really big schematic that was drawn up by one of the partners of this project, the Center for Conservation Biology at William & Mary College. So the biggest thing, like I said earlier, was managing for this pine savanna habitat. And I don't know if any of you have been to southeastern Virginia or northeastern North Carolina, but it's very rural and a lot of it's in private agriculture land. So there's just not a lot of natural habitat there. So managing for the habitat was the big thing, and setting fire is a big part of that. So most sites, they would be doing a lot of prescribed burns, but the nature of the swamp was actually unique, so we didn't do that due to the peat soil and the dangers that fires actually have there. So you manage the habitat with logging and thinning and treating invasive species and fire, and then what you have to do is create their homes inside the trees so that they're ready to go once you bring them from somewhere else. So this photo is actually the person, Brian Watts, who made the schematic. He is up in the tree there taking care of the artificial cavity that they created. So from the beginning, if there's no artificial cavity at all, they have to climb to the top of those ladders and they have a chainsaw and they chainsaw out a certain amount of the tree. And then they put this next step in, these artificial cavities in. And then they put, stuff around it to make it stick in there. And they spray paint it so it looks like it already has this natural resin on it to try and keep predators away. And then we get the woodpeckers from somewhere else, and I'll go into that. That's the exciting part. And once we bring them there, hopefully they live in their homes, lay eggs, feed their babies hatch, and so on. So that's sort of a brief overview of the whole cycle. So let's go more in depth about the reintroduction process, because that's the fun part, and that's where I come in. Oops, someone's trying to come in. Okay. Here we go. So, like I was saying, they need to pick out the perfect tree. So starting here, the pine trees, they need to be chosen really specifically based on age, size, and proximity to two or three other good candidate trees to create this artificial cluster area so that the cluster of red-cockaded woodpeckers can all be living close to one another. So they put these white bands around the trees that they're in because it's just easier to see from the ground. And also areas that have them open to the public, they can know which trees they're in. So after the forest is managed and after the trees are picked out and the cavities are put in the trees, there is staff who are at one of the sites that have a good population of birds who are monitoring different clusters just before dusk every single night where there are males and females staying. so that they can keep track of who's staying where. And if they stay there for like so many nights in a row, then they're bound to stay there on the night that we're gonna try to capture them. And this is another photo from the Center of Conservation Biology with the employees there. And so this is a really good start of trying to see, okay, where do I even start looking for these trees that birds might even be in aside from hearing them? They make a lot of noise before they go in at night. And so this is, like I talked about earlier with the resin, you can see all the pine resin, it looks really sticky. So that's a good way to tell, okay, there's definitely birds there. Let's look at those trees for a couple weeks and see who's there. And then this one doesn't have a lot on it. So you're like, okay, there's probably no birds going in there. And after weeks of monitoring, weeks or more of monitoring where these specific aged birds and sexed birds are staying, the translocation night is set to begin. So once they've headed into their cavities for the night, the staff will be far away watching, like I showed you in those photos with their scopes, and they will quickly and quietly approach the tree that they see the birds go into, and somebody will have either a rake or a bat, and then somebody else will have this giant expandable pole with a big net on the top. And we have to like time it really perfectly, and we get this pole all the way up to the cavity hole, and then we'll start tapping on the tree so that the bird might think it's a predator and get scared and fly in through the net, and then slowly and carefully pull the pole down, and then put the bird very carefully into this little box. And then the road trip begins. So for us particularly, we were getting our birds from the Carolina Sandhills National Wildlife Refuge, which is all the way in South Carolina. And here we were all the way at the Great Dismal Swamp in southeastern Virginia, close to Virginia Beach. You can see how huge it is. So we had staff and partners who were all the way down here in South Carolina doing this effort all day long and all night long. And then they would get them around right after dusk. And then what they would do is hop into their cars and drive all the way to the swamp, which was, as you can see, like almost 5 hours away. And then I was already at the swamp that night. So I met them out in the area where we translocated the birds, and then I'll talk to you about what we did next. And then there was actually a second night where we did a translocation event. And this place was a lot closer. It was less than an hour. And this is a really good place to see red-cockaded woodpeckers if you want to see them. This is probably the most northern spot. Piney Grove Preserve and Big Woods Management Area is right next door, which is open to the public. Cool. So once they come to the swamp at really late at night, we had our very experienced staff and partners climbing up the tree. So this was that same person who was in the tree in the last picture I talked about. And he climbed up with the bird in that little box, and then he would put it in the cavity hole, and we had like a chicken wire screen, and you would have thumbtacks and you would sort of lock them in for the night. And then there's this giant string, you can see, if you can see my mouse, that's going all the way to the ground, and that would be special for the morning. Yeah, it's a really beautiful photo taken by Bobby Klontz, who was another person who helped out, and he worked at the Piney Grove Preserve, so he knows a lot about the red-cockaded woodpeckers. So in the morning, it was totally beautiful, and the sun was rising, and we pulled that string from the ground, and you can see the tacks and the chicken wire screen would come flying off, and the birds would come flying out and they would start making their morning noises with the hopes that they would pair up with the other bird that we put in that tree grouping, the cluster, which always happened, which was really exciting. So it was always a female and a male. And right when we opened up the screen, they would always be like, whoa, that was a crazy trip last night. Where the heck are we? And it was really great to see. And then what we would do is leave this area of the swamp alone for a few weeks or even up to a month or two, I think, just so it would be quiet for the birds and they wouldn't get scared and maybe fly away. And then the winter monitoring would commence, which would just be us doing the same thing, monitoring the cluster, the tree clusters, seeing who's where. And then it would happen again in March. So, like I just said, the springtime monitoring would begin. And this was a little different than the winter monitoring. Here we were not monitoring with our binoculars or our scopes, but we were monitoring here with this little camera. And it was a similar apparatus to the net that we saw earlier where it was expandable. So it could expand up to like 60 feet, even though most of our artificial trees were 25 to 30. Some of their natural cavities that they decide to create are a lot taller than that. So what we would do is we would check all the cavities for signs of wood chips on the inside, which would be a sign of nesting. So the birds would peck away at the box on the inside to create this nest so that they could have their eggs on that. And then after we saw which ones were active, we would go out and monitor them, those ones specifically, once a week with this camera apparatus to see if there were eggs. Yeah, and so this protocol, this weekly protocol of monitoring these trees, it can tell us when they lay their eggs and how long they've been incubating them and if there's nestlings and how old they are, so we know when we need to band them. So with this, obviously the goal was to hopefully find babies. So here's a photo from that camera inside the cavity hole. And we had a little screen that you would be carrying on the ground. And you could see on that screen what was going on inside the hole and in live time. And you can take screen snippets of that. So this is a screenshot of... it might be three, but it looks like two little babies. And this was in 2016. And they just look like they're sleeping there. So yeah. So this is really good information to have, because then the partners would go out and climb up the trees and they would take the babies out and band them. So that's where this comes in. So how do you track the success of this project? How do you track what's going on? Like, that's so great that they had babies, but now what? So you take them out of the cavity hole very carefully and band them here. Like you can see on their legs, the color bands, the blue and silver and the purple and yellow and purple. So it helps us monitor the population and how it's growing and where people are going and who they're staying with and where they came from. So I can't remember exactly what each leg band meant, but it was something along the lines of one leg meant female or male, and then the other one meant which location it came from and what year that it was found and just information that we would need like that. Yeah. And so then this is another really good photo that I just wanted to share. Cause after they're banded, that's great. You put them back in, but then you still need to keep monitoring them to see, okay, which babies survived, which ones are going to fledge. Cause they don't always live. So you can see there's clearly only two in here all grown up. So they would be fledging, which is really great. And then everything starts all over again. So once they've fledged, in May or so, end of May, beginning of June. Everything starts all over again. In the summer, you need to be taking care of the forest and cutting down the trails and cutting around the brush around the artificial trees that we made and getting ready for the translocation event in the fall. Here we go. So with this project comes a lot of challenges. So like I was saying, there's sort of a lot to do between when they fledge and when the translocation event begins in the fall. So cleaning out the cavities is a big thing that needs to be done sort of perfectly timed out prior to when they come. So you can see in this photo, there's a really big spider and it looks like it has a face on its abdomen. It's a really weird photo that we got. And that was when I was there. And there's also, it looks like there's like an old mud dauber nest on the side there, which is dangerous for the bird to be shoving a bird in there if there's stuff that could hurt them. And you can see there's more mud daubers in here on the side. But the bottom looks pretty clean. there's also other animals that would be living in there. So these kind of look like fox squirrels, recall. But we saw lots of flying squirrels in there when I would shove the camera in there. They were just sort of hunkered down and living their life inside of these artificial homes. And we saw chickadees and whatnot. So trying to get those out of there. If it was a chickadee, just taking its nest out. We had this vacuum thing that you could vacuum up in there. So that was one way to clean it. Another challenge would be the storms. We get a lot of storms in that area of Virginia. And this was a photo from, I don't know what this is from, but it was an artificial cavity was inside it. You can see like clearly where the chainsaw was. And the tree must just not have been big enough and the winds were too strong and the cavity actually made it a weak point in the tree to snap right at that point. Another challenge would be predation of the birds. So the year I was there, we translocated 10 birds, which is a lot, but with all these other factors such as the storms and other predators that could be getting in there, predation is just another thing on top of that. And so this is just a photo of feathers that my supervisor found on the ground and she assumed it was a hawk. And so she made this like silly little image of a hawk looking like a devil. So the latest news. So this is the part that kind of excites me because I was working on the project so much. When I was there, the latest news was this was the first natural cavity. And I think I might have helped find it or maybe I was with someone. But you can see this is like 80, maybe 60 to 70 feet up in the tree. So that's really tall where the other ones would be much further down. We don't know why. They made them so high in the trees at the swamp. It might have been because the understory was so tall, so they naturally just didn't want predators to be able to get up easier. We don't really know. But that was really exciting news because that was the first natural cavity documented in the swamp in 40 years. So that was really exciting. And there's been a lot of natural cavities since then, which is really exciting. But it does make it hard. It makes it a lot harder work, especially at the Dismal Swamp, which is a really hard place to navigate to begin with. So as of 2020, there were 5 new natural cavities. So that's a lot, which were all about 40 to 55 feet tall. That's what my former supervisor told me recently. And they have more breeding pairs than when I was there, which is good. And this is sort of older news, but it was really exciting at the time. As of 2017, there was a total population of 96 individuals in that southeastern Virginia area. So between the swamp and the Piney Grove Preserve/Big Woods Management Area, there was 96 individuals. which was a lot compared to 2000. The year 2000, there was maybe two or four that they knew of. So that's great that it was working. All the efforts are working. And that's most of everything I did with that project. I could go into a lot more details, but these are just some other projects I worked on when I was down there in Virginia living. I worked on the breeding bird survey and the Virginia Breeding Bird Atlas 2 and the Christmas bird count when I was at the swamp. And then when I was volunteering on the weekends, I was doing feeder watch. And you can't really see this logo at all, but it says Hummingbirds at Home, which is a citizen science project through the Audubon Society. Similar to feeder watch, but just with hummingbirds. And then some other work I was able to do was do some banding, helping out banding. I wasn't doing much banding myself at a station not too far away. And then I was also helping out with piping plover work at another national wildlife refuge not too far away. So helping out building exclusion fences and going out and just trying to track down adults with their babies and count how many were there and stuff with the other interns there. So that's a really brief overview, believe it or not, of the work at the Dismal Swamp with the red-cockaded woodpeckers. And this was actually on the second reintroduction night this photo was taken. So thank you so much for listening. And if you have questions, I can try and see if they're in the chat, or you can just unmute yourself. And so this is a really, also another really cool thing. I mentioned the Center for Conservation Biology at William and Mary that helped us out a lot with the project. And they actually have an Amazon Smile account. And so I don't know if any of you know what that is, but it is, every time you shop on Amazon, some of your purchases could make donations without you having to spend extra money to a nonprofit organization. And one of them is the Center for Conservation Biology at William and Mary. And they do tons of bird work. They don't just do red-cockaded woodpecker work. They do bald eagle work, peregrine falcon work, yellow-crowned night herons, whimbrels. So they're definitely worth looking up and looking into the Amazon Smile because you don't have to spend any extra money to make donations, which is cool. So that's that.
You mentioned that the trees snap easier after they've been had a nest in it. How common is that?
When I was there, it was fairly common because the summer or the spring before I came, there was a lot of really heavy winds that spring. So that was a fairly common thing. And also the trees at the swamp were just so much smaller. Like the best trees we could find at the swamp were small compared to other places that would have red-cockaded woodpeckers. And I haven't heard any recent news about that happening. And since their population has been retaining better in the last couple of years since I haven't been there, I'm assuming their natural cavities are doing better than the artificial ones.
Do you know if the if they hybridize at all with, say, downies or hairies?
I don't know that. I would assume no, just because of their life histories and the way that they breed with their, like, family groups that they live in. So I would say no, but that's just a total guess.
On a good night, how many birds would they get to transport to the swamp?
Yeah, I would say the year I was there was a really good year. They had a lot. They had 10 in total. So the first night from South Carolina was 8. So it was 4 females and 4 males, I think. And then the second night was just we just wanted 2 more. So we got them from the place a little bit closer. So it was 1 female and 1 male.
So Audrey, there are a couple of questions in the chat box.
Oh, here we go. Sorry, I didn't have it pulled up. Yeah, so end date to the translocation efforts. Is there an end date to the translocation effort? Is there a target population for the area, or will they continue indefinitely? So their goal is to have 5 breeding pairs within 5 years. And so it started in 2000. I think their first translocation was 2015. Because their first year, they weren't really expecting to have babies because the birds were all really young and they were trying to figure everything out. In the second year, they did have a few fledglings, which was great. And then my year was really weird and we didn't have any, which was unfortunate because I really wanted to help out with some of the stuff that was involved with that. I don't know about an end date, but they said they wanted 5 years to have 5 breeding pairs, which would be this fall. And I don't know if they're at that goal yet. And then I think they're gonna leave it alone because it's such a hard area to do work in, that they're just gonna see how it retains after that rather than keep pushing them in. Is there a target population for the area or will they continue? So yeah, they're just gonna see how it works. The site nearby where we got 2 woodpeckers from at the Piney Grove Preserve, theirs has reached like their maximum capacity, apparently, according to the people at the Center for Conservation Biology. They said, a couple years in a row, it was right around the same population and they only had so many fledging and whatnot. And then the year I was there, the number actually went down a little. So they had been seen at a nearby property, like expanding their own range on their own. So that's pretty good. But yeah. And so have I been to other sites with red-cockaded woodpeckers? No, I have never. That is the only place I've ever seen them. I went to Alligator River National Wildlife Refuge, and I guess they're there, which is in North Carolina, but I never saw any there. Oh, and then the place where they came from in South Carolina, I did go to my second day of work there. We drove 5 hours to South Carolina to help them with the efforts of monitoring them. But I was not all the way down there for the translocation night. Fortunately, I was sleeping when they showed up at 1 a.m. and then we headed out into the swamp. So you mentioned that they breed in family groups. Does that mean that second year birds stick around and help raise them? Yes, that's exactly what that means. So the second year birds, the second year males, I guess in particular, they'll just, they'll help raise them and learn. And then the next year, they'll try to have their own. And so that's another reason I mentioned why they sort of are they're less hardy birds just because they have that really specific life history and they don't lay their eggs until later in life.
Cool. Other questions for Audrey?
I have a question. Do they leave that area? Do they migrate somewhere? Or are they there year-round?
Yeah, they don't migrate. They don't migrate. They just stay there all year. We assumed that some of them left our site and they could have potentially flown all the way out to that site that was less than an hour away, or even Alligator River wasn't far. That was also an hour or two away, so they might fly that far, but they don't migrate.
Do you sense there's much competition between other species of woodpeckers? Are they territorial and other species, say the downy or hairy, would compete or chase them away?
That I'm not really sure of. They eat mostly insects, so I think it's mostly the same diet, but yeah, I'm not sure about that.
But you never had to evict a downy woodpecker from a red-cockaded cavity?
No. Just chickadees and squirrels, flying squirrels. And so I forgot to mention this, but a big reason that they have all that pine resin around their cavity hole, they'll actually like poke it to make the pine tree have it get all sticky like that, is because of predators like rat snakes. So the rat snakes can, they climb up the tree and they'll go in there and eat them. So that's why they make it so sticky. And I don't know, I thought that was worth mentioning. So they have seen rat snakes inside cavities.
Cool. Any other questions? Well, thank you so much for taking the time to share that with us today.
You are very welcome. Let me make you the host again.
Thanks.
Thank you, Audrey. Thank you.
Oh, you're so welcome. Thanks so much for coming. I hope you learned one thing.
I've been there. I've seen them. It's a very strange, unique location.
And yeah.
You just don't see much else there except poison ivy.
Yeah, you don't. It's like a wall of plants. It was like machete territory. Mm-hmm. You know, it was really hard to navigate. And it's just a unique place in terms of natural history and human history. So it's worth reading about if you've never heard of it or don't know much about it.
Very cool. So our next program is October 20th, and we're going to do that on Zoom as well. Some of you remember Samantha Apgar was a PhD student at UConn who presented, I think it was 2019, about salt marsh sparrow research she was conducting. She's going to come back and give us a follow-up on kind of where that's at and how that's wrapping up. So hopefully folks will join us for that. Holly, did you have anything you wanted to add?
No, just looking forward to seeing all of you and tell others about this as we sort of move into this age of technology when we can't be together in person. Because we'd love to have more people come and hear these wonderful programs. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Audrey, and good luck with your studies.
Thanks.
Yeah. All right, well, have a good night, everybody.
Hey, thanks, Corey.
Thanks, Audrey. Nice to see everyone.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks a lot.
Bye, Paul.
Thanks, Audrey. Bye-bye.
Thank you.